Well, during the fall season, we will have for you here on this section of our website the availability to be able to look and see where the foliage is best. And usually every season, we have a lot of questions from viewers about how the colors change on the trees and what types of weather might affect the foliage in a given season. So we brought in the big guns for this today. We brought in Mike Gagnon. He is from Hillsborough County, and he's the official forester of Hillsborough County. Mike, first of all, thank you very much for joining me. I yesterday petitioned folks to ask me those general questions that we get. So we're going to kind of consider this the normal FAQs that we get every foliage season as we anticipate what should be a really great year. And so what we're going to do is we're going to go through a bunch of these and feel free to answer them any way you like. And so now whenever I'm asked these questions, I'm going to point everybody right to this video. No pressure. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Christine wants to know, when is the earliest time that leaves start to fall off?
All right. So there are general patterns that happen throughout New England that we're all aware of, but there are certain trees that change earlier. And I always think of red maples that are in what we call red maple swamps. And those tend to change first. So I start seeing those in August. They start turning red. Because of stress conditions of having their feet wet, or in our case, this past year, having their feet dry for a lot of the year and then becoming very wet.
So that does answer Lisa's question. She says, why do some trees, basically the swamp maples, go so early on a given season? Is it because they are basically underwater?
Yeah, and I think this year, you know, it was a little odd. It's related to stress and the trees shutting down. It's because they're either underwater or in the case until we had this month of July rain, right? They were really dry, which caused another stress. It was a dramatic changes in their growing condition.
So we tend to see on foliage season some subtle changes just because of the stress of the seasons. And this year, we started the summer in moderate drought, had a very dry June, and then obviously a very epic, almost historical month of July with the rainfall. And then, you know, we have the third warmest August. So yeah. What does that witch's brew kind of translate to on the other side?
Yeah, I'm hopeful because of the rain we got. So, you know, there was concern with the drought that's causing, you know, a lot of early stress on trees. But we got enough rain early while the trees were still growing that, you know, they're pretty resilient. And, you know, you'll see trees here and there that are under more stress than others. But, you know, on a whole, when I look outside and I'm driving around the county and meeting with landowners, I see lots and lots of green foliage still. So whenever there's lots of green foliage, I'm hopeful for a really good season of leaves changing color in the fall.
So Kathy wants to know, there's still a moderate drought up in Coos County. Will the vibrant of the colors be a little bit different there? And is it worth traveling there? Or do you think, you know, that kind of cancels itself out and it's not going to have a huge impact on what you see?
I think it's worth traveling there. And if you want to chase the seasons, you want to go north first. Really, the changes in fall foliage are related to temperature and the signaling of winter coming, which is really the one consistent thing, is the shorter day length. But I think we're going to have a really good foliage season up north.
That's great to hear. Jen wants to know, what is the difference in brightness of the leaves in the foliage in a wet summer versus a dry summer?
I would say that's probably going to be more related to the conditions that the trees are under, you know, starting now where I'm starting to see splashes of color on trees and it's just getting started through mid to late October. So we all know that like leaves are green and that's chlorophyll, and the process of photosynthesis is about absorbing light. So plants are really good at absorbing lots of light, and what they're doing is reflecting back some green light. They're actually absorbing most of the visible light, which is the, you know, Roy G. Biv, red, orange, yellow, blue, indigo, violet. And then they're reflecting back some green, and that's why we see trees as green to our eyes. And so once solstice happens and the days start getting shorter, the trees stop producing chlorophyll. And then they sort of unmask different pigments. And the ones that are already there are yellow. And those yellows and oranges, they're called carotenoids and xanthophylls, they become unmasked, and that's when we see the color changes. What happens in the fall, getting back to the question, is when we have really sunny days and cold nights, that adds to the stress as the trees are shutting down and they're no longer making chlorophyll or repairing themselves. And so that stress creates another pigment, which is those brilliant reds. They're called anthocyanins. And those aren't unmasked. They're not already there in the leaves all year, but we can't see them because of the chlorophyll. They're actually created. And so what we need in the fall, not so much the year, whether it was dry or wet during the year, but over the next 6 or 8 weeks, what we need is nice sunny days and cold nights. And that triggers a lot of red anthocyanin production. It's actually, the red is actually an ultraviolet filter. So think of it like a sunscreen for the leaves. Because while the trees are shutting down, they're also trying to extract every bit of nutrients they can and store it in the roots and as carbohydrates. And so they're actually creating sort of a sunscreen protective mechanism when it's sunny to get as much out of the leaf as they can before they fall off. And so also, when it's really bright and sunny, the trees reflect that red and that orange and yellow. So it can be really the daily conditions, whether, you know, if it's overcast, they're not going to make as much red. And if it's not sunny that day, you're not going to see it with your eyes as that brilliant color. So
already I am standing here corrected because I didn't realize that, you know, day to day, week to week, as you start to get toward the foliage season, has that much of a difference. But apparently it does, and I apologize for the last 15 years of the answers I've been giving people. And I'm glad that you're at least on record with this, and already this is proof positive of why we've had you here today to do this. Thank you. Lori wants to know, does all of the rain, if we were to have a wet fall, keep the leaves around longer?
I think the rain we had in July would probably keep the leaves around longer because they're still really actively growing. And so, you know, water is how trees or cells stay alive and stay healthy in plants. They got to have that water inside them. So,
all right, just a couple of more here. Andy wants to know if the leaves are basically, if we have just a normal next month, are they on time ahead, or do you think they're going to fall a little bit behind on what a normal peak season would be like on this graphic I have behind me?
You know, there's no magic crystal ball for predicting, but we do a pretty good job by looking at a lot of historical data, elevations, and length of day to predict it. You know, a lot of research says that when there's a lot of drought stress, which we had, it may come a little earlier. So several, you know, things might be 2 or 3 days earlier as you move from north to south across the state.
Yeah, that was actually Nolan's question. He was wondering what kind of technology is used to figure out when peak happens.
Yeah, the crystal ball, right?
My magic 8-ball works really well most mornings at about 3 a.m.
I think that all that historic data and our knowledge of, you know, daylight changes and mean temperatures and elevations helps us really predict it. But I think it's kind of messy, too, in that, you know, one side of a hill is different than another, and a low area that gets cold air at night is different than an area that's sunny. And so there's a lot of variation, although we see this sort of consistent pattern when we look at it from far away. Yeah.
All right. So the last one here from Lisa, I think you kind of answered this earlier. Actually, it's Michelle. She says, what makes foliage turn yellow instead of orange or red?
Yeah, so what makes foliage turn yellow is the carotenoids or xanthophylls that are already in the leaves. And there's so much chlorophyll in the leaves that we don't see it. And then as that chlorophyll is not repaired or replaced as we get into the fall, it breaks down and then I call it unmasking, right? It unmasks the yellow pigment. So some trees are very genetically predisposed to certain colors. I think of birches, very yellow, or hickories. And then I think of other ones like red maple or sumac to be very red.
All right. I think you have given us plenty to chew on here, and I am happy to point people to this video with any questions you have. Mike Gagnon, Hillsborough County Forester from the UNH Cooperative Extension. Did you know there's an actual phone hotline that people can call during business hours?
Did I know that?
Yeah.
A phone hotline for extension?
Yeah. There's actually during normal business hours, people will call, and I've done this myself, and there will be a live person on the other end to answer any questions you have. That number is 603-351-3831, or you can email them at the UNH Cooperative Extension at answers@unh.edu.
Yeah, thanks a lot. And That's the info line or the Ed Center, and we work really hard answering people's questions, and there's lots of us, and those questions come in, and people help answer them, and they filter them out to other specialists as needed to get the right answers out to people.
Well, Mike, I truly appreciate you taking the time to join us today. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.